good to see you all. What a great way to start off our service. God is a lighthouse. What a great imagery that in the darkest place, God is our light. And as church, right, as a church, we are, if you remember our series of Revelation, we are lampstands. We are a light shining in a dark world. We're reflecting God's light. And so what a special morning it is. Driving here, it was like so beautiful. And I quickly was reminded how many things I have to be thankful for, and yet how little of my time is spent being thankful. That was convicting. So as we're starting service today, I hope that we are able to find a lot of joy in community. I mean, if there's ever anything to be thankful for, it's this group of people right here. So I hope this is a joyful time, a time of celebration, a time of reflection and contemplation, and that we would honor God in all we do. So let's get started, and I will pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you, Lord, that even in the darkest hour, even when there's so much darkness in the world, that you are our light in a dark, dark world. Lord, and I pray that we would reflect the light of the gospel, the light of Jesus to all the world. Lord, and I thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship together. Lord, I pray this morning that we would worship well. I pray that you give Pastor Christian the words to say from your word, and that we would be transformed by your word, Lord. That we would continually be focusing on how we can grow closer to you, not further away. Thank you for all that you give us. We pray that we honor you this morning and this week. We pray this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church family. Let's stand and worship together.
Thank you. Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Hidden glory in creation, now revealed in You are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Couldn't have heaven without You.
Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so very much for that name that is so powerful, so magnificent, so above all description, Lord, that it is in your name that we want to find ourselves. It is in your name and your love, Lord, that we desire to find our identity, to find our purpose, to find our hope, to find our dreams, to find our longings. Lord, for the opportunity to come and to be able to worship you, to be able to study your word, Father, to be able to know you, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, the one who is above all things and all description, and that we are able to have a relationship with you, not because we've walked into your presence and demanded an audience with you, the King, not because of our work and our lives, like we have earned some kind of favor or special place with you because of what we've done, what we've paid, or who we know, or the things that we've earned. Lord, that we are in your presence and seeking your presence because you have invited us in, not by our work, but by the work of your Son. And that our desire is to come before you humbly, to lay our lives before you, to lay all the things down that we think that we have achieved, earned, the accolades, the titles, and all of it. Because all of them compared, all of them combined together, compared to your majesty and your glory, Father, all of our accolades and all the things we have accomplished in our lives, combined together, all of humanity and all of time, don't even come close to the depth of the reality of who you are as God and King. And so allow us the courage and the humility to lay aside any notion that we have that we may deserve this, or we may have earned this opportunity to be in your presence, because we haven't. We are here as your special guests. We are here welcomed by your Son who did all the work for us. And so allow us to sit at your feet, to be able to sit before the power and the magnificence of your Holy Spirit and your Holy Spirit's teaching in our lives, and guide us as we are studying your word. Allow your word to come alive for us. Allow our hearts to be willing to humble themselves, Father, before you, and to say, speak, Father, because we're listening. And so, Lord, right now, we ask these things in your precious, amazing name. Amen. You can be seated. Well, if you missed us last week with homecoming, it was a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. It was good to be able to visit, to fellowship. It was really good to be able to have some food together afterwards. Amen. That was some good food. We've got some good cooks in this church. And so thank you everybody who provided dishes. Thank you for everybody that served and set up. We had a wonderful time last week. I hope you had a wonderful time. And right now what we're doing is we are in a series where we are looking at what is it that makes a Christian a Christian? What is it that makes a Christian a Christian? That's really the question that we're unpacking in this series right now, that's called Real Christianity. That's called Real Christianity, and what we're doing is we're studying through the book of 1 John. Matter of fact, if you have your Bibles with you, go ahead and turn to 1 John chapter 3, whether that's your Bible in person or your Bible in app. If you don't have either, we're going to have those available, the text available for you on the screen here in just a moment. But in this series, what we're doing is we're looking at the marks of faith that distinguish real Christians from cheap imitations. Those who are actually believers versus those who simply think they may be believers. And so far in just two chapters of 1 John that we've read so far, we've discovered seven... So we've discovered seven defining marks of faith with more to come, by the way, but we've covered seven so far. And today, we're not going to be covering any new marks of faith, but we are going to discuss and dive deeper into the seven that we've already covered. And we're going to really work today to answer the question, it's a very popular question, is what is it that makes someone a child of God? right? Because there's this sort of prevailing question or thought in all of culture is that aren't all people God's children? Isn't everyone a child of God, right? Because in culture, that's what everybody wants to believe. We have speakers and authors and entertainers and politicians and social media personalities and celebrities who have all stated in one way, shape, or another that we are all God's children. Tennis legend Arthur Ashe, a poet by the name of Anna Monar, Muhammad Ali, singer Dolly Parton, Alice Bailey, who's an author, author Thomas Cahill. There are even Christians, right, people who call themselves Christians or Christian organizations who have said just as much. Joel Osteen, Mormons on their website have said that we're all children of God. Pope Francis, Mother Teresa, even evangelicals, right? Because this is starting to saturate into evangelical Christianity, and there are a lot of evangelical Christians, which is what we would be, right? That we would be evangelical Christians. There's a Christian page called the Southern Christian Coalition, and on their page it says directly, we are all children of God. There's a singer by the name of Ray Davies, who's the singer of a British band, the Kinks, and he says this, that the day we're born, we were God's children. Russell M. Nelson, who's the president of the Mormon Church, said, who are we? We are children of God. Our potential is unlimited. Our inheritance is sacred. A senator by the name of Barbara Boxer said, we're all different, but yet we are all God's children. We're all united behind this country and the common cause of freedom, justice, fairness, and equality. That's what unites us, right? So all of this sounds amazing. The idea that all of us are God's children, it sounds wonderful, it sounds beautiful, right? Who can't love a sentiment like we're all God's children? But there's one very, very big problem. That sentiment isn't expressed anywhere in Scripture, not one place. There is nowhere in the Bible that says every single person is God's child. Matter of fact, it actually says the opposite. It says that not everyone is a child of God, but it actually clarifies exactly who is a child of God. Looking at the Gospel of John, keep 1 John 3 because we're going to go to that. I'm just going to go back. I'll have it on the screen for you right now. In the Gospel of John, so you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, chapter 1, verse 12 and 13, John says this. Or it says this in John. It says, but to all who believed him and accepted Jesus, right, he gave the right to become children of God. The right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or a plan, but a birth that comes from God himself. Right? So what it says is those who believe and accept Jesus, they are reborn. They are given a new identity, not just a new identity, but they're given a whole new DNA, right? And that they become a whole new creation. That's what 2 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us, that the old has passed away, right? And the new has come. Those who believe in Jesus and accept him as their Savior, they are reborn and they are then given the ability to be called children of God. That's who children of God are. Now, does that mean that God doesn't love or care about non-Christians? No, it doesn't. It just means they're not part of his family. It means that they are not children of God, but they can become one. That's the distinction. Let me tell you something. Do not buy the cultural lie where you buy in and you go, you know what? I think I like just saying that everybody is a child of God. Because when you do, you muddy the gospel. You take away. Matter of fact, if that's the case, then what you're saying is what we just read in John and what we're going to read through 1 John chapter 3, what you're really saying is the work that Jesus did on the cross was actually pointless because we're all God's children. That when we just want to accept and just say, you know what, because it just sounds like such a beautiful sentiment, we don't want anybody to feel like they're unloved, so we're just going to say that everyone's God's child. But that's not actually the case. Matter of fact, scripture even goes a step further. I don't even have this text for you on the screen, but it says that without Jesus, we're actually enemies of God. Right? What kind of family, they look at each other and they're like, we're all enemies, right? That's not a very loving family. What Jesus says, in my family, we are loving. But those that are outside the family are in actual, they're in direct conflict with the kingdom of God because they're not living for me and my things. They're not living for God and God things. They're actually living for themselves. They're trying to build up their own kingdom that's in competition with the one true kingdom, and that would be God's kingdom, okay? And so this question that we're answering actually matters. And in 1 John chapter 3, John clarifies exactly what it means to be a child of God. And so we're going to read verse chapter 3, verses 1 through 10 together. Let's read this. It says, "See what great love the Father has given us, that we should be called God's children. And we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it didn't know him. Dear friends, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet been revealed." Right? That's talking about eternity. "We know that when he appears, we will be like him because we will see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin practices lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed so that he might take away sins, and there is no sin in him. Everyone who remains in him does not sin. Everyone who sins has not seen him or known him. Little children, do not let anyone deceive you. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who commits sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the devil's works. Everyone who has been born of God does not sin because his seed remains in him. He is not able to sin because he has been born of God. This is how God's children and the devil's children become obvious. Whoever does not do what is right is not of God, especially the one who does not love his brother or sister." This is the word of the Lord. Okay, now a quick note on today's sermon. We're going to spend the bulk of our time just in those first couple verses. We're going to elaborate on the rest of the verses a little bit later in the message, but the bulk of our sermon is going to be focusing on what does it mean to be a child of God. And in this passage, and not just this passage, right, but all of the book of 1 John, all of 2 John, and even 3 John, the apostle takes time to describe with great wonder and beauty what it means to be part of God's family. Right? What does it look like to be one of God's children? Because again, even in John's time, this isn't just an our problem today problem, but even in John's time, there's a lot of false teaching that exists trying to let people know that this is what it means to be a Christian. This is what it looks like to follow Christ. This is who Jesus is. And people are actually denying the real Christ. That's why in chapter 2, we looked at 2 weeks ago, so many people were leaving the faith because they were buying lies. And so John, in contrasting with the culture and being countercultural and presenting the truth as truth, right? Here's what the Bible says. He says, here's what it means to be a part of God's family, right? Here's what it is to be a child of God. And he does so with such beauty and wonder that when you're reading it, it's hard not to be kind of awestruck by it. But in the same way that he's declaring it with beauty, he's also drawing a line in the sand. And he says really clearly, 1 John especially, very, very clearly, there are some who belong to the family of God and some who don't. There are those who are God's children and those who are not. Put another way, everyone is an image bearer made in the image of God, but not everyone is a child of God. That's perhaps one of the biggest distinctions. And what happens is a lot of evangelical Christians, Christians in general, we confuse the power and the beauty of what it is to be made in the image of God with the reality of what it is to be a child of God, because they're not the same thing. Everybody, every single human breathing is an image bearer, right? This is how we were created. We were created to reflect the image of God. We actually talked a lot about this in our doctrine series last fall and even earlier this year, like January, February-ish. We talked a lot about this, but in short, in Genesis, when God created people, it says that he made them in his own image. Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, it says that God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. So that one verse has a whole lot of information in one verse. But what it says very clearly is that when God made man, he made us to reflect his image. We are all image bearers. The people that you don't like are image bearers. The people that drive you nuts at work are image bearers. The person that just cut you off in traffic, may God bless that image bearer. Right? When your children are running around and they're doing the things that children do, and you start to wonder, Satan, have you got a hold of my child? Is this one of your demons or one of my children? That is an image bearer. Okay? We are all image bearers. Being an image bearer, understand something, is a very privileged position. To be an image bearer is a privileged position, because we are the only part of all of creation that God has made possible to reflect his image. There is no other part of creation that was created in God's image or to reflect his image but people. Right? That's why it's so special. But when we conflate it and we go, well, everybody's God's children, well, you've overstepped. You've gone too far. It is one thing to say we are all made in God's image, and you'd be 1,000% correct. It is one thing to say that we are made to reflect the image of God, and you'd be 1,000% correct. That we are made to reflect his image, but being capable of reflecting his divine attributes is not the same thing as saying all people do reflect his divine attributes. And while God may have said that we're all made in his image, and by the way, that even means the squirrely ones, he never said that all people were his children. All people are created special. We're a special creation, which means we are created with beauty, worth, value, dignity, and intimate design. But not everyone will walk in the joy of those identity markers. All people are created with the ability to be in relationship with God. They have the ability. All people have the ability to be in relationship with their Creator. But not everyone will desire to have that type of relationship with God. That's the point that John is making in his letter. Everyone is an image bearer. Everybody has value. Everybody has purpose. Everybody has dignity. Even the Republicans and even the Democrats and everybody in between. No matter who sits in office, when you're praying for them, pray for that image bearer. Everybody is an image bearer and has value and purpose and beauty, but not everyone will choose to walk in those as God's children. There are several key distinctions that separate God's children from image bearers. I'm gonna show you 27 of them. I'm just kidding, four. We're gonna do four. Okay. Four key distinctions. There's a lot more, by the way, but we're gonna look at four this morning. The first one is this. Image bearers are able to acknowledge the eternal character of God, but only God's children can see, understand, appreciate, and reflect them for other people. Image bearers are able to acknowledge the eternal character of God, but only God's children can actually see, understand, appreciate, and even reflect those eternal characters, right? We're talking about characteristics like love, justice, goodness, righteousness, holiness, beauty, truth, integrity, selflessness, right? And that's just to name a few of them. But God's children are left in awe and wonder when they see God's character displayed. In verse 1, matter of fact, it even says, John said right off the gate, he says, see the depth of God's great love that he has for people, right? But I like how the New King James and the King James actually starts. That they don't say the word see, they say behold. Behold. Now, John's, the word see says the same thing. We're used to the word see. Like, hey, did you see the dog, right? We use the word see very commonly, so it's easy to skip what John is saying when he says, see what great love the Father has for us. When you actually read that statement alone, you kind of go, oh, wait a minute, let me think about that for a minute. What kind of love does the Father have for me, right? So the King James and the New King James actually says it more profoundly where they say, behold what great love the Father has for us, right? Pause, stop, reflect, think about, play it back in your mind, play it back in your heart. When's the last time you stopped to think about the value and the depth of the great love that God has for you? Because children of God know better than anybody the great love that God has for us, because we also know the great depth of our sin in our lives. And we know the great price that Jesus had to pay to make us children. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But Jesus had to pay a great price for us to be God's children. We know the depth of our sin. So when John says, stop and see what great love the Father has for us, that means all the things that you've done in secret, that you've tucked away and hidden away, and you're like, man, I hope nobody ever finds out about this. God knows about it. The thoughts that you've thought, even though they never came to fruition, you thought about it. You actually started to wonder if you should plan it. God knew about that. And Jesus still died for you. And he still loved you enough to love you to death, that he would give up his life for you. That's great love. And John says, don't miss how great the Father's love is. Stop on that, because that love is what makes it possible for you to be a child of God. Without that type of love, this relationship is impossible, right? So that sounds wonderful. Matter of fact, that would be a great end to the sermon, period, right? But the verse continues. And then also says, the reason the world doesn't know us is that it didn't know him. Right? Children of God, they recognize and appreciate the character of God, which is why we can't stop thinking about it, dwelling on it, and reflecting on it, right? Because one of the things that separates a child of God from an image bearer is a child of God constantly goes back to reflect on the great price and the great love that the Father has for us. Image bearers are just like, I'm here and I'm ready to mingle and I'm ready to party. Right? They're just ready to do life. But children of God keep going back. But children of God recognize and appreciate the character of God. But see, here's the thing. Everybody else is baffled by the character of God, because they saw God's character. They saw his work. It's kind of hard to miss. Walk outside and look at trees. Look at creation. It's really hard to miss the awe and beauty of God's handiwork. It's hard to miss the power of God in creation. But they've seen God's work. They've heard his word or heard about his word. They've heard about him. They've probably heard about Jesus and his work on the cross, though they may not understand it. So they've heard and seen a lot of things. But what John says is they still didn't know him. They don't get him. Image bearers, they might believe that they're created by God or a God. But they have no idea who he is. Which, by the way, means they're not going to recognize God's children very well either. They're not going to understand seeing godly character in God's people when they see them reflected. Right? But by contrast, children of God know exactly who God is. They've not only encountered the character of God, but they've stood in awe of God's character. Because we have faced God's justice. We saw how much our sin cost us, and that there was actually a price for our sin. It was death. We have stood in the awe of God's justice and realized this is going to cost me everything. And then we've also stood amazed and inspired by the grace of God when he says, I'm going to pay for that for you. And I'm going to die for you. We have stood amazed and awed and inspired by the grace of God. Children of God have even modeled it for other people. But here's what the world finds really confusing. More than just not being able to understand God is when people of God say that they're Christians, but their character that they're reflecting is not godly character. The way that they live their life and the way that they model their life, it doesn't reflect God, it reflects something else. Matter of fact, John in verse 10, he really cuts to the chase. He says, you're going to be one of two things. You're going to be a child of God or you're going to be a child of the devil. Right? Verse 10. So everybody wants to say everybody's God's children. That's not what John said. He said, you're a child of God or you're a child of the devil. And when Christians say, I'm with Christ, I am a Christian, I have his name, but they live counter to that, it baffles the world even more because they're already baffled by the character of God, but what they really don't understand is if you're a Christian and you have his name and you're living for him, but you don't honor him as God, you don't love him as God, you don't reflect him as God, I don't know who you are, you're just like us. And it baffles the world. There's a Christian author by the name of Brendan Manning who said it best. He said this. He said, the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, they walk out the door of the church, and they deny him by their lifestyle. That is what an unbelieving world simply finds unbelievable. God's children know God's character. They're moved by it. They're awed by it. They long to be a reflection of it. But when we fail to reflect his character, we're not only robbing ourselves, but we confuse the rest of the world. Number two, the second distinction is that image bearers, in many respects, are spiritual orphans because sin separated them from their creator. But Christians are God's children because Jesus united them with God through his work on the cross. Okay, so image bearers, in many respects, are spiritual orphans because sin separated them from their creator. But Christians are God's children because Jesus united them with God through his work on the cross. Let's put it more simply. Image bearers know about Jesus. God's children follow him. When sin entered the world, okay, it separated people from a perfect relationship with God, right? When sin entered the world, it was at that point that God's creation, who all the image bearers were separated from God, and there was this wall between them called sin, and it was keeping them at a distance from one another. It left image bearers to wander alone as if they were spiritual orphans, separated from their creator. But because of the great love that God has for us, right? Verse 1, because of God's great love for us, God didn't want to leave us as orphans. He wanted to make us children. And so he sent his one and only son to die for us and to pay for our sin and to break down the wall that was separating us from God. And that means through Jesus, he invited us to be part of his family. And scripture says that instead of leaving us as orphans without a father, he adopted us into his family. Right? That's why being a child is such a big deal, because it's not something you're born into. Instead, it says that we're born into sin, we're born into being orphans, we're born separated from God, but that in his loving kindness, he adopted you and he paid the price for you to be a part of his family. And we see this in a ton of different verses in scripture. Let's read some of them, okay? Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5, it says this. It says that God decided, and we're going to fly through this, so just write it down if you want to go back and read it later. But Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5, it says that God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. When you stop and behold that verse, that it gave God great pleasure to bring you into his family. He wanted to bring you into his family. Romans chapter 8, verse 15, it says, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him, we don't have to just call him God, we now have the ability to call him Abba, Father. Right? That name got even more personal. God is personal as it is. But to be able to call God Father, come on now. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. It says that for you are all children of God through faith in Jesus Christ, right? And this is Paul talking to a Christian audience, that you are all children of God through faith in Jesus Christ, because that's what makes us children of God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19, it says, so now you Gentiles, in other words, those who are non-Christians, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, right? In other words, you are no longer people without a land and no longer people without a home. You don't have to be spiritual nomads anymore. That you are a citizen along with all of God's holy people, right? Notice it didn't say that you are a citizen with all of humanity. He says you are a citizen with God's holy people. You are members of God's family. Last one, Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 through 7, it says this. But when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law, and God sent him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law, so that he could do what? Adopt us as his very own children. And because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. Now you are no longer a slave, but you are God's own child. And since you are his child, God has made you his heir. And what does it mean that we're his heir, right? That we're going to get an inheritance, right? Everybody's like, amen, sign me up. What am I inheriting? We're going to inherit God's eternal things. All the eternal spiritual blessings that God has, we inherit. We become, matter of fact, other passages say we are co-heirs with Christ, right? So thanks to sin, people who are made in God's image are separated from God, but in God's loving kindness, he's now invited us back into relationship with him to be his own children by believing in Christ, trusting his work on the cross, and committing their lives to follow him. Because why would we follow anybody else anyway? If Jesus is the one with all the answers, why would we go anywhere else other than Christ? Why would I follow anybody other than Jesus? Third distinction. The third distinction is that image bearers are able to enjoy the good gifts of God for a limited time and in limited ways. But only God's children can enjoy these good gifts in full, both now and in eternity. Image bearers are able to enjoy the good gifts of God in limited time and limited ways. Let me explain what I mean. James chapter 1, verse 17 and 18, it says this. Well, it's really just verse 17. It says that whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, right? So in other words, all good gifts and all perfect gifts come from above. What are just some of those gifts, right? There's a whole multitude of gifts that God makes available to us. But some of those gifts are love. Like we can be in loving relationships, both from a marital aspect, but also relational aspects with other people, like with friends and family. Okay, so God has given us love. He's given us goodness. He's given us peace and joy and intimacy and beauty and life, right? All of these are gifts that come from God. They point us back to God. They inspire us to worship God, and they allow us to understand and enjoy God more deeply, but they also help us to understand people more deeply. That when that person cuts us off, it allows us to start thinking about them a little bit more deeply than just that person that cut me off and I've now got ill thoughts. That I can not only think about them as an image bearer, but that image bearer was worth Jesus dying on the cross for if they're willing to surrender their life and follow him. That Jesus was willing to go to the cross for that person that just cut you off. These good gifts allow us to understand people and the relationships that we have more deeply. You see, in this life, most people say they just want to experience goodness. They're like, I just want to have a good life. I just want to experience peace. Why can't I just have peace? Why can't I just have joy? I just want to have a fresh start in life. But without a relationship with God, hear me now. I want you to hear me on this. This is very important. Without a relationship with God, people may get a glimpse of those good things from time to time. but they're always going to be short-lived. That's why so many people live lives bouncing from relationship to relationship, or bed to bed, or weekend to weekend, or experience to experience, because they're trying to find or create or recreate those things which can only come from God. But children of God not only get to experience those good gifts in full now in right relationships, but we get to enjoy and embody those traits, those good gifts, for all eternity, right? For children of God, goodness, it's not rooted in just one moment or one experience. That goodness for Christians, it's rooted in God who is eternal, right? That's why Christians, we have to be careful not to be like, well, I went on that one mission trip that one time and it changed everything. It was so powerful. Why can't everything just be like that one mission trip or that one church service or that one camp or that one retreat or that one thing that one time, right? We're not one-time people. We have a God that's eternal, and the good gifts that come from him aren't limited to awe experience. We don't have to live like this life is all we get. We realize that this life is actually a launching pad for eternity. For children of God, peace isn't going to be found by avoiding bad things. It's going to be trusting God in all things. For Christians, joy isn't fickle like happiness is. Joy is a work of the Holy Spirit. For Christians, self-control, it's not a punishment or a restraint. It's a safeguard and a blessing, and it's a dream keeper. For children of God, we long for eternity because we know that's when all of our questions are going to be answered and all of our dreams are going to be realized. That's why in verse 2 it says this. Of 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, it says that we know that when he appears, when Jesus appears, right? In other words, when Jesus comes back. When Jesus comes back, we are going to be like him because we will see him as he is. Image bearers, for those that are image bearers, they live like this life is all they get. For image bearers without Jesus, this life is as close to heaven as they're ever going to get. But for children of God, this life is as close to hell as they're ever going to be. Because for children of God, they know that this life is just the beginning. That one day we're going to see Jesus, we're going to be with Jesus. We're going to look even more like Jesus. And we're going to be able to enjoy him even more than we ever could here. That's the beauty of the gospel. Number 4, the fourth and final key distinction is that image bearers are created to look like their creator, but only God's children seek to understand and reflect their creator, right? In other words, to do the things that God does. The image bearers, they only want God as a provider, but children want him as their God and their king. God's children, they want to learn how to do the same things that Jesus did, and they want to understand the things that Jesus did, right? And they want to do the things that Jesus did for the same reasons that he did them. That as Christians, we're going to use the rest of our days learning and emulating Jesus. And we want to learn how to dream the same things that God dreams. Like verse 2 talks about what it looks like to see people in our lives who are far from God draw near to him. What would that look like? Do you have some names on your mind right now of people who are far from God? And what it would look like one day to see them say, Jesus, I'm here, I'm home. To dream about that and have that as a prevailing dream in our lives. We want to learn how to hate the things that God hates. Things like lawlessness and rebelling against God's authority. We want to learn how to despise deception and lies and darkness, right? In other words, we want to learn how to hate sin. Because that's a work of the devil. And what Jesus said, what John says in 1 John 3 is Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. He came to destroy those things, right? So in other words, Jesus has no love for dark things. He has no love for non-kingdom things. He came to do two things, to destroy that which is of the darkness and to save that which belongs to him. day by day, year by year, God's children learn more and more the value and joy that comes from rejecting sin. We are never going to find joy. Listen to me. Do not be deceived. You are not going to find joy, lasting joy in this lifetime, embracing your sin or hiding in it, ever. That's why Jesus tells us, we've said it multiple times in this series alone, God doesn't call us to hide our sin. He calls it to confess it and to repent of it, to have nothing to do with it. But God's children also want to learn how to love the things that God loves. That we want to learn how to love Jesus. We want to learn how to love the Father and the Holy Spirit. We want to learn how to love offering forgiveness to somebody. They may not even ask you to forgive them, but to learn the value of offering forgiveness, because for some of us, there are some of us right now that we can't even find joy right now because we're so mad at something that somebody has done to us, perhaps years ago, or people have done to us, or the things that weren't done and that were promised to you. And we lock ourselves in this prison. And I can't remember who said this illustration, but when it comes to forgiveness is one of these weird jail cells, because it's the only jail cell that we willingly walk ourselves into. We take the key, we lock the door, and we put it in our pocket. And we keep ourselves there in bitterness and anger and resentment and hurt and longing, instead of, as children of God, learning the value of what it is to offer forgiveness, mercy, and grace, and to find new life breathing. God, thank you. The reason we want to forgive is because we were first forgiven. We don't have to wonder, man, I wonder what Jesus thinks about me. We know what Jesus thinks about me. Jesus died for me. He loved me. He forgave me. In the same way that we're forgiven, we're forgiven much, we want to learn how to forgive much. We're loved much, we want to learn how to love much. We want to learn also how to love righteousness, right? That 1 John 3, it says that if you belong to Christ, you're a child of God, you do right things. You do righteous things. That we want to learn how to love God's word and his commands. We want to learn how to love obedience. We want to learn how to love vulnerability, transparency, integrity, humility, right? Because those are all characteristics of light. When we are too embarrassed and too ashamed to come before the Lord and say, God, here is me. Here's all the things that I've been hiding. Here's all the things that I have done. Here's all the things that I'm ashamed of. Here's all the things, like whatever all the things are in your life. And we tuck them away in a box. Or we're like, you know what? I wouldn't mind talking about walking with God and living like God, but you know what? I don't know. I don't really know all the answers. Like, shame prevails. And we tuck whatever it is that's in our lives away. And we hide them in dark places. But what the Bible tells us is that we're supposed to be walking in light. That's what 1 John says. We're supposed to be walking in light. And as people who walk in light, we want to learn how to value being vulnerable and transparent and honest. That we want to learn how to revalue repentance and turning from sin. We want to learn how to value holiness and being different by God's standard and not just different by a world's standard. Where we're not just image bearers, but we're holy, set apart, and we're free from sin. See, the world longs, I love this about the world. And this is, I'm not knocking the world here. I'm not insulting the world. We're not against the world. Jesus, for God so loved the world, right? We're not against the world. But what I always find funny about the world is the world values uniqueness. You have to be unique. But you go to every high school and everybody looks the same. And you go to every college and everybody looks the same. And women all dress in similar shopping stores and malls, right? And they're like, I love that outfit. What do you think? Can I pull this off? Right? And they dress the same. Guys are like, no, I don't really care about all that, but we want to be the same too. Sometimes it's like, I want that fishing rod. I want that boat. I want this or this, right? But it's funny how much the world wants to be unique. The world longs to be unique, but believers, we have to long to be holy. We have to long to be separate and different. Not different, unique, like the world thinks of unique. We want to learn to be holy and different, to look like Jesus. that we want to learn how to love godly community with other Christians, and we want to learn how to love God's people. Because sometimes, let me tell you something. Can we just be honest for a moment? Sometimes it's easier to love strangers than it is to love your own family. And sometimes it's easier to love strangers than it is to love your own church family. But God said the prevailing mark of God's children is that they love their family. They love their church family. If we can't love our church family, if we can't love our family, then we're missing it. But the more we embrace these traits, the more we embrace these marks, people are going to see Jesus and the power of his Holy Spirit reflected in us and through us. But the more we mask, deny, and reject these traits, the more that we embrace the things that Satan loves. And we're never like, I just embrace the devil. That's all I do. I just want to, whatever Satan's good with, I'm good with. Like, we never say that. But man, if you looked at the checkbook of our time, where do we spend more time? Doing things that Satan would be a bigger fan of, or the things that God would be a bigger fan of? When we look at the checkbook of our checkbook and our money, where do we spend more of our time? The things that God loves and God honors, or the things that he doesn't, right? How do we spend life, our minutes, our days, our purpose? In this series, we're looking at the marks of real Christianity, what it looks like to be a Christian from a biblical perspective. But these aren't just generic traits. They're not just generic marks, right? Instead, these are actually our family traits that we're learning. And they work together in parallel ways. That first of all, these traits remind us who we are and whose we are, right? They're our identity. And lastly, these traits are also a spiritual roadmap for our lives, because they help guide us, inspire us, mold us, shape us, and lead us into new life. Day by day, minute by minute, moment by moment. Being a child of God and being known as a son or a daughter of God is our greatest identity. It's our greatest hope and our greatest reality. Are you a child of God? That question matters. And if you haven't heard anything that I've said today, and you don't have Jesus in your life, and I say, are you a children of God, a child of God? You're probably going, yes, I am. And the Bible says, no, you're not. That without Jesus in your life, you're an image bearer, you're beautiful, you're wonderful, you're better than all the notes you put on your mirror to remind yourself of how great you are. Not because your notes say you are, but because God said it first. You are all those things, but you're an image bearer. Without Jesus, you're not a child of God yet, though. If you're not a child of God, God's invitation for you is to lay down yourself, to lay down your life, to stop living for yourself and loving yourself and follow him. His chief desire is that you would know how deeply you're loved, and that he doesn't want you to be a spiritual orphan. Let me tell you something. He does not want you to be a spiritual orphan. He wants to call you his son or his daughter. Did you hear me? The God of the universe, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the infinite creator of all, wants to look at you in your heart and in your eyes and call you a son or a daughter. If you are a child of God, let me ask you this. Is it obvious to others that you're a child of God? Is it obvious to yourself that you're a child of God? If someone could see your heart, would they see a heart that truly loves God, his word, his commands, his character, and his people? If people could see your thoughts, would they see someone who disciplines themselves to set their mind on things above? Eternal, holy, godly, wonderful, spiritual, amazing things. Not generic, but specific to Jesus. If someone could see your failures, would they see someone who embraces their sinfulness, or someone who every day goes to war against their sin, who values repentance? If someone could see your schedules or your priorities, would they see someone who prioritizes loving and walking in the things that God loves? If you've never put your faith and trust in Christ, and you'd like to talk with somebody today about that, or perhaps you've been running and wandering from that, and you're like, you know what, I want today to be the day that I don't run anymore. Or there are just some things in your world right now that you just don't know how to really process. and you just want to spend some time praying about that, the altar is going to be open. You're welcome to come up here and pray. You're welcome to come up and talk with me. I'll be standing over here. I'd love to answer any questions that you might have, perhaps. Right now, if you would please stand. And let's pray together. God, we thank you so very much for loving us. We thank you so much for your kindness, for your loving kindness. As verse 1 says, behold the great love that God has for us, Lord. Allow us to pause for just a moment and to ponder and consider the great love that you have for us and what that means. How beautiful is that love that you have for us? How beautiful is the fact that you forgave us, even though sometimes we struggle to forgive ourselves? That you would love us, even though sometimes we struggle to love ourselves? That you would care for us, even though sometimes we're our first priority and our last priority in the way that we schedule our time in our lives? Lord, that you would send your Son to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. And I pray that in humility, that would be the starting point of worship for us, to realize that you're not a commodity added to our lives, that we're the neediest people in the world and we desperately needed you. We worship you because you're the only one worthy of it. And I pray, God, that if there's anyone here, when we're not talking a theology class. What's the difference between an image bearer and the difference between a child of God? The distinction matters for one reason, because that's where the relationship with you resides. It's not so we can walk out and say, I learned something today. It's so that in this place and in this space right now, we might be transformed more and more into your glorious image, that we would reflect you and that we would model new life that comes from you. And so, God, right now, I just pray that you, in this space of this time that we have for singing this song, and even this week and weeks to come, Lord, that we would consider greatly what it is to follow you and to surrender our lives to you. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
I count on one thing. Same God that never fails. When I fail me now, you won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Oh, my days. Yes, I will. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. The waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh yes, I will. Oh,
so glad you all are here today, able to worship with us, to be a part of this. This morning service, and more than just being present to kind of, we're not going through motions here, right? But that we have the opportunity to encounter, what our mission is, we want to encounter God, equip people, and engage our city, right? That what's happening here, Sunday after Sunday, is we are encountering a living God, and that we're coming here, every one of us, with a lot of things in our lives as well. And so that the ability to come before him and to pray and to be in relationship with him, right? That's what being a child of God is all about. And so I'm going to ask you to have a seat really quick. I have a handful of announcements that I just want to make really quick, and I don't want you to stand through those. But first of all, just want to let you know that we have two Bible studies that are starting this week. We have a women's study that's going to be starting, and we have a foundations class that's going to be starting. A women's study is going to be starting. Both of these, by the way, are five-week studies. They're going to be on Tuesday nights from 6:30 to 8 p.m., 6:30 to 8. The women's study is being led by Cindy Grasty. It's a study in the book of Ruth. And so we've already got several women that are signed up. It would be helpful for you to sign up either for the women's class or the foundation class, which I'll tell you about in a moment, because it helps to give us an idea of room space, supplies, things that we need. But you don't have to sign up. If you show up, we've got a place for you. But again, it does kind of help us with preparation. Cindy and I were talking this morning. We're like, hey, which room? And we're like, we don't know, because we're waiting to figure out how many people are going to sign up. So if you could, you just go to our website and sign up. It's super easy. The women's class, you need a book, but if you can't afford the book, show up, we'll give you a book, okay? But if you can't afford the book, how much was the book? I can't remember. $16. Okay, and so, and if you're like, I don't have that right now, don't worry, just come in, grab a book, we'll take care of that, okay? The foundations class doesn't need a book, it's not a study, it's open for anybody, teens, adults, young adults, whoever. It's on Tuesday nights, again, 6:30 to 8, along next to the women's study. This foundations class is called Real Habits, Real Change, and it's learning the value of stewarding our lives, like stewarding our time, stewarding rest. What does it actually look like to rest? The daily rhythms of our life, the spaces of our lives, right? How do we pray? And so we're going to be looking at a lot of different things, spending some time. It's not just to come and listen class, but it's actually going to be a very interactive class. So come on out Tuesday night. It's open to anybody, 6:30 to 8. And then let me think. There is no childcare for these classes. Just wanted to give you a heads up for that. But Tuesday nights. Also, next Sunday, it's already here. I can't believe it. But next Sunday, Lord willing, weather permitting, we have our fall outreach. It's the family fall festival, and the corn maze at the Crossroads Corn Maze. There we go. The Crossroads Corn Maze has graciously allowed us to be able to come, and what we do is we rent out the corn maze for 2 hours. Anybody that comes in that 2 hour span can enter for free. Last time I checked, I think admission's like about $15 a person. How much? 17 a person, right? And so for 2 hours, when people come in that time span, it is free. They allow us to pay a flat fee. We basically rent out the maze and turn it around and open it up to the community. And so it's been a tremendous outreach for the last couple of years. They are, Lee and Paula, who are also members here, they own it. They're just tremendous in allowing us to bring inflatables and cotton candy and popcorn. And we hide members all through the maze and we pass out candy. And so it's a lot of fun. But that is next Sunday, believe it or not. We're already in October if you missed it. We're actually halfway through October if you missed that. Some of you already got your Christmas decorations up because we passed July and that's when those go up, right? And so next week is our family fall fest. We have a lot of opportunities to serve, but today's sort of the deadline to sign up. But we definitely have a lot of different spaces for you to plug in and be a part of. Our biggest needs right now are we need more people, lots more people to kind of go out and be a part of the passing out candy in the corn maze. You get to go get lost in the stalks, hang out there for 2 hours. If 4 hours passes, we'll send Chuck. And so to go and find you. But you don't even have to come out to get more candy. We actually are going to have some teenagers that are, and anybody who has able legs, and they're like, no, I want to do it. They're to run candy too. You just got to sit there and interact with all the families that come through, pass out candy. So we need people to pass out candy in the corn maze. We need somebody to kind of spearhead the cotton candy, the popcorn. We need a couple extra hands with the inflatables and watching the inflatables once they're running. And so if you go to the table that's right out here, you'll see all the different areas to sign up right here on the right-hand side by the Connection Center. Please sign up before you leave today. We also need more candy. Thank you for those that have brought candy in. Believe it or not, we actually still need more candy and prizes to be able to pass out. And so please, you can bring that in until next Sunday. And then one last thing is invite your friends and family. We have some flyers that are out here. You are able to take those, pass those out to all the different family, friends, coworkers. You can post them at work. Here's the only thing you can't do. You cannot share the flyer on social media. Okay? You can take a picture of it and text it to your friends and family. You can't share it on social media until next Saturday night, because what we don't want to do, because they offer us such a good deal in renting the corn maze, that we don't want to take business away from them. If all of a sudden Wake County finds out that they can go for free all at the same time, number one, we would overwhelm the corn maze. But number two, they wouldn't go on Friday and Saturday and pay if they were going to. All right, so we can't post it on social media, but take the flyer, pass it to different people, invite them, say, hey, our church is sponsoring this. You can come for free. The only thing you have to pay for is concessions if they want it. But otherwise, hay rides, corn maze, free candy, inflatables, popcorn, cotton candy, all of that's free. That's a fun night. And so anyhow, if you haven't been a part of this, I highly recommend serving, because let me tell you, we have a blast every single year. Don't be afraid to dress up, by the way. We have a lot of different people that love to dress up in costumes. And so anyway, the flyers are at the table. Grab those on your way out. And the last thing I wanted to make mention of is I wanted really quick, just wanted to recognize a couple of things. Number one, I don't know if you noticed or not, but we have, I can't call her a special guest because she's a very dear part of our church family, but man, it sure is good to see Sandra back in church this morning. And she is back home. Am I able to share information at this point? Okay. And so she came into my office Thursday, I think it was. She and Chuck came in and she said, I want to let you know, the doctor, we just left Chapel Hill. We went to our last appointment. And the doctor has said that right now I am in deep remission. How good is that, right? We had Scott and Lisa come up a couple weeks ago. Scott Featherman over here and Lisa Anderson. Oh, there you are. You keep moving on me. That's not very Baptist of you. You're supposed to, you got to stay in your place. Lisa, we brought Scott and Lisa up and we prayed for them because they had, Lisa was going to be having, I think it was six different biopsies. All of them came back, no cancer, right? And Scott went into, we had prayed over Scott. He was going to be going in to have surgery on his brain to remove a lesion, to remove a tumor. Went in that morning. It's a long story, so I'm going to give you like the hyper Reader's Digest version. But the hyper Reader's Digest version is, half of y'all don't even know what Reader's Digest is. I just thought about that. The short version is this, that he went in, the doctor pulled him into a consult and said, we can't do the surgery. The MRI shows that it's in a different place. It's going to be way more risky than we realized. Instead, we're going to do a biopsy, and we're going to make plans from there. But if the biopsy goes well, our hope and plan is that we have a new drug that was just approved by the FDA, and it was actually produced by Duke in large part. And they said the game plan will be, if this comes back favorable, instead of surgery, we're going to start treating this with medicine. And he had the biopsy. He's here, by the way. So he had the biopsy. And he's recovered really well from that. Still a little bit of lingering effects, so but be praying for that. But he's here. But the biopsy came back favorable. No cancer. And so he's going to be, they're working with him now about the treatment plan and things. We'll be praying for them in the days to come. But how good is God? Amen. Right? Man, that is tremendous. If that doesn't make you smile and want to dance and scream and shout, I'm telling you what, and the fact that Jesus is king and he's on the throne, you're going to have to check your pulse. I'm just telling you. Okay? If you would, let's stand. And let's close with the singing of our doxology, because we have a great, great God. Miss Serena.